Shall we start? Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you and a very good morning to you all. My name is Dr. Reem Shimri, the Kuwait Oil Company, CISO, as well as the chairperson of the Oil and Gas Cybersecurity Committee back in Kuwait. I'm also the technical lead representative in the GCC Cybersecurity Committee. And what makes it even better, I'm a co-founder and a board member in Women's Cybersecurity Middle East Group, where we have more than 600 remarkable ladies, varying from executives up to rising stars and students. Yesterday, I made a deal with my audience or guest in the keynote session I did in She Speaks. And I was wondering what to actually to get their attention, full attention, and it went very nicely. And I was wondering what kind of a deal would I make with my audience today's session. Then I looked at the title, and I said, Oil and Gas, Cybersecurity Journey. There's no deal. The one who will be attending, they are very much interested, and they are peers and cousins in this industry. So since we already have that communication and channel open, being a peer in this industry, I believe the deal is already set. And my part goes on making it interesting and insightful as much as I can, as I have flown over than 16 hours of flight to be here on this stage. So thank you for attending, and I hope you'll have some takeaways to go back in your industries and implement them successfully as we have done. Starting with, who is Reem? So, back in 1999, I joined oil company with a Bachelor of Computer Engineering. And with that passion of working and giving back, because, well, they always say best managers lead and best leaders share stories. And the best stories are the personal ones. So I'm going to share with you a story here. My father used to work in the refineries in oil companies back in Kuwait. And he passed away in 1989 when I was 14. But for me, as I was growing up, I saw him very much committed. Being a manager in an oil and gas refinery, he always went to work very early before even the sunrise. As we used to have breakfast, he just goes, grabs his cup of coffee, and goes to his work. For me, that built for me commitment, passion to work, and paying back to country. And that's what I'm doing. And I will share a secret with you. I'm putting on his t-shirt, white t-shirt that I kept for more than 31 years, just to feel his support and presence. This is my own way and personal way of having his support as a role model in my life. Academia. What I've done from an academia-wise. My mom actually struck a deal when I was 4 years old with the principal in kindergarten. Back in the days, which I will not mention so you can't calculate my age, but she made a deal with the principal that I will join the kindergarten at a very early age. So I joined the kindergarten at 4 years old. There wasn't back classes of pre-KG. But because she loved so much learning and getting me into that very early age in kindergarten, I loved the passion of learning. And I knew that I would keep learning every time, every day from anyone I meet and I get connected with. I did my PhD in business, my bachelor's in computer engineering, but that never stopped me from learning. Recently, I successfully graduated from the Harvard Business School in the General Management Executive Education Program. And that by itself was a journey of learning where many perspectives and enlightenment has been gained. From governmental wise, I have been always in KOC. My blood is blue because the logo of our company is blue. My supervisor, when I first joined work, I didn't join it like any other UD or a newcomer. He told me, Reem, I have a vision. I would like to make out from you a wild card. Wherever I inject you, a success story will come out from an IT project you're involved in. So that's what he did. And I can assure you, it wasn't a pleasant journey at all. It was full of challenges, full of pressure, but we know that with pressure, diamond is generated. And for me, that diamond of experience and knowledge has been generated. And up till last night, I was texting him, thanking him for helping me in becoming who I am and how experienced I became. Yet, more experience is yet to be gained, and learning is a continuous journey for me. So I am the chairperson of Kuwait Oil Company Cybersecurity Committee, as well as the technical present lead, and we have so much connections and collaborations with other entities and communities within the region, and even global-wise and industries from team members and teammates in cybersecurity. Women, I always believe that women can always make a difference with the support of men. In yesterday's keynote session, I have shared my view of how women and men complement each other. It was never men versus women at all. In my life, men has complemented me throughout my journey in very various roles, being a supporter or a role model, or even a mentor or a coach. And even agents. I had my sons as an agent to help their father checking and taking after their brothers and sisters when I was back in Hartford doing my learning journey. So it's always about complementing each other. And for women, I have contributed and I loved to support women and making a tribe. Not because it's a war versus each other, no. Because we understand each other. We would love to support each other and we will be able to understand and translate that support into action. I'm also the Kuwait representative in UK Gulf Fellowship Program and the Cybersecurity of Women Forums. I've been a keynote, a speaker, also panelist in various national and international as well as regional conferences. That comes from my belief that we need to contribute in any possible way. We need to give back to this community. Because if we all of us start contributing, this community will always flourish and have an added value. Please don't let this agenda strike you. It might be a very long agenda. Yeah. Don't tell me I have to repeat all of that. I don't. Did you all hear me?
Yeah.
Excellent, thank you. So although it looks a long agenda, but I assure you, we'll go with it smoothly and quickly, hopefully, but not very fast, so you can understand my language, because English is not my first language. So we'll go through the oil and gas journey. How did it start? Where the collaboration has emerged? Why did we collaborate? What challenges was there in that collaboration? And being a woman leading that collaboration, what was the lesson learned and takeaways from that? The maturity assessment that we had utilized as a tool, and also the national cybersecurity alignment that you have to do always with your environment and with your country in order to be successful in your implementation and not to do it as a standalone show. Then the way forward, and of course the strategic outcomes and the takeaways. But I'm going to state it as in a Hartford's way, the way I have learned it just recently. So let's start with our journey. As a journey or a storyline, we always need to have a vision. And in order for you to have a vision, you need to define a business objectives and goals for that vision. And whenever you define a vision, you always need to involve the business users with you in drafting that vision. Because after all, it's not only you who will be implementing it. You're drafting a vision for a business owners, and those business owners will be implementing it. And my motto in my company and my team, we say, we are not the bad guys. We're not closing everything. We are cybersecurity. And we enable business in a secure manner. And this is how they should see us as business owners. We should talk their language, we should avoid the tickies and make them see us as UFOs or foreigners from space. We need to do a presentation about cybersecurity without saying the word cybersecurity. That's a challenge, but we can do that by replacing our acronyms with their acronyms. Instead of cybersecurity, we can talk about resilience, we can talk about disruption, we can talk about optimizing our operations. After defining your objectives and goals, you need to define and determine the cybersecurity strategy. And lucky enough, in our Kuwait oil sector, we were able to define that strategy for 2040. So having that amount of look and perspective for 2040, we were able to use it as our milestone and our baseline in drafting that journey. So we had defined and alerted to our collaborations
that we need to collaborate as key company entities, and we have around 9 companies in the oil sector back in Kuwait. So we told them we have a vision of 2040. If we will make it more than just a pile of papers, then we need to collaborate. After establishing the collaboration, then a framework where we have defined a cybersecurity common framework for all these 9 companies. And that by itself is a challenge. And we'll talk about that in details. Later on, we used a tool for assessment to measure the maturity and also developing the target operating model, where do you want to be and what's the next step to take it forward. In oil and gas, I believe this is very much similar to those who are peers in my industry. We have different operations, varying from exploration, developing, and as well as exploring, going to the export marine, and as well as refining, then marketing the oil. It's all connected chain. And when we talk about the whole sector, not one company, my company actually goes over the 3 main operations: the explorations, the development, and the export and marine. And you can see that logo of Kuwait Oil Company. But the whole sector covers the other portions, and we have 9 companies doing that. Being an oil company means you're a national critical infrastructure entity. And back in Kuwait, our oil companies contribute to our national GDP in more than 40%, and the national income of 90%. And securing an entity that contributes into the income of 90% is a big burden that makes a person have difficulty in sleeping at night. And actually, some people call me a vampire because I sleep late, very few hours, and I keep waking up during the night because I'm very much concerned with that burden of responsibility. It's never easy to be a CISO while being a mom and being a responsible person as well. Although we have 9 companies throughout the sector, but we have the same pains, the same challenges. And I bet that we have the same challenges throughout all the industry of oil and gas. And even so, if we look at the other entities, even other companies, private or public, will have the same challenges. We start with the human factor. Many of us call the human factor, which the theme of RSA is the human element, as the weakest link in cybersecurity. I have a different view of that, although it's projected here as weakest link. But I believe with the right investment in our humans, they can become the strongest link. After all, these tools, these solutions have been developed by humans. And if these humans are being involved, they can be our strongest link. You know what Confucius said? Tell me, I forget. Show me, I remember. But involve me, I will understand. If we involve our users, if we tell them what is the impact of being cyber aware, of being very much aware of your actions, and being careful in assisting us and protecting our companies and our country by itself as a nation, they will help us. They just want to be aware that they are part of something important, and they are. And once we get that involvement, they move from being the weakest link into the strongest link. Lack of regulatory framework, because we are in Kuwait, we still have, let's say, amount of work to be developed on that one. We do have strategy regarding cybersecurity on a national level. However, the policies and standards are still being developed. So as oil and gas entities, we cannot wait for that. So we need always to develop our own and make sure they will always align with that national entities and guidelines. The other thing is being connected. I mean, cybersecurity and attacks vectors are getting more complex, and all of us knows that. The connection and communities, trusted networks, are always being compromised by using even the supply chain attacks, by compromising the ones that you trust. With that having in mind, and with entities of oil and gas back in Kuwait having these trust connections, we need to secure all of these entities, because it's not just a one company's issue being compromised. If an attack happens back in Kuwait, they will not say that company has gotten compromised. They will say Kuwait oil and gas sector has been compromised. And this means our whole reputation. So that's what we need to work all as one in order to secure that reputation of the whole oil sector. Digitalization, as I said, we are not the bad guys. We are here to embrace digitalization. And I love technology. I'm not being sarcastic, but I love cloud when it's being deployed in the right manner, when it's being understood and mapped to your business requirements. So we are the business enablers. We are the digital transformation agents that will help these business owners to make that transitional move in that secure matter. Because if they do not take us as allies, then at a later stage, disasters will have an impact to and disruptions to business will be occurring for sure. Skilled cybersecurity resources. There's a big debate of when we say there's a big shortage in 2022 when we have a 2.3 million gap in our skilled resources. I believe we have rising stars. I believe we have. I mean, just by looking at my 9 years old daughter, I know that there is a skill and there's intelligence, students and even capabilities that's rising. We do have a shortage, but we can always utilize and make best of what we have right now, utilizing also the tools of AI and machine learning as well. Having also the risk of reputation, as I mentioned, one entity gets compromised, the whole sector reputation goes down. I mean, check the coronavirus with all our prayers to those who have infected. The stock market is going down because of that. So it does, and reputation goes fast and impacted very hugely with this social media connection for social media news and platforms being connected very quickly. In OT, as we call it, industrial control systems, OT or operation technology, we talk differently when we talked about IT. They have their own language, we have our own. But we all share that we need to secure that infrastructure. It's very complex. However, we don't have to be that well educated in OT, but we need to understand their business. We need to know how it's really connected and where are the crown jewels there. Getting to know OT and working with OT for the past 9 years, when I used to be the digital oil fields IT lead in these projects, I had the burden of securing these digital oil fields while introducing that digitalization. I was very much concerned of what can happen wrong if that digitalized environment goes impacted or got compromised, and those operators back in the field will be impacted. And we have seen some attacks in the ICS where lives can be impacted heavily. Will I be questioned? I was thinking of that burden, and from that, my cybersecurity passion came to be more broader and more concerned to secure that fields. So for them, they need to have it safety, and for us, we need to have it secure. We will always reach a win-win and compromise solution once we understand their business requirements. OT is a very nice environment. It's never easy to secure an OT environment. We have legacy systems. You don't know who's the owner in some cases. The complexity of these, how they integrate with each other. And at the end of the day, you say, we're isolated, 100%. Then you find a dashboard coming out in the management office and say, how does that connect? And then you just get to know they are really not a 100% isolation. And we know all of us that OT environment have their vendors who use maintenance remote applications, and they can always get that connected. So the theme or the, let's say, I call it as a myth of being isolated 100% in OT. For me, it's a myth. There's always a connection one way or another. What we need to know is it's okay. You can tell us about that connection, and we'll do the work to secure it. So we had three main challenges. We had a common cybersecurity strategy absent before having the 2040 strategy being laid out. We had a lack of budget where each company had to go and request for budget on their initiatives and their different roadmaps for all three, the other nine companies. And of course, cascading attack, where we say where a network of companies, trusted network, can be compromised. So when we have the 2040 strategy, with that cybersecurity roadmap initiative has been laid out clearly and loudly, we came as advocates. Let's utilize that strategy for our best. Let's make it, let's utilize it and actually take it into an action. Instead of having a study by consultants, which we always highly appreciate as our partners and strategic partners, and keeping that pile of paper on the shelf, let's take it into action and into implementation and development as well. And that's what we did with our collaboration. We have requested to collaborate in order to lead, in order to leverage the resources and capabilities, and in order for us to implement these actions, these initiatives into actions and roadmaps. So we have witnessed, since we have initiated that collaboration forum, different achievements. And this is just a sample of these achievements, as today we're still getting these achievements and outcomes. We have developed a unified cybersecurity framework, which we'll be discussing in very further details later on. We have unified an awareness campaign, where the same campaign of awareness goes in the same pieces of all over the nine companies. One voice, one message is being delivered over these nine companies, employees, and staff. Cybersecurity progress programs, where we have continuous check-ins and continuous audits and compliance as well. Compliance, because once we have developed that initiatives and cybersecurity framework, we were able to recognize the capabilities and the development gaps for that maturity assessment in order to reach it. And we're there, we became more compliant to the standards and frameworks and policies as well. We have initiated different initiatives and cybersecurity assessments for throughout the sector. We always believed in playing the role of a family. Whenever any company needs help, we can recruit these resources to help that company. Whenever they have a challenge in that solution or that technology, we can utilize that company who have the capability to serve the other company. And this has been done all within the K sector. K sector stands for Kuwait, and K sector for the oil sector. So the magic recipe, the cybersecurity framework, it consisted of four main areas, where these four main areas has consisted of 34 capabilities. These areas are the strategy, the resilience, also the vigilance, and of course, the security. I always believe there is no entity that is 100% secure. And whenever a vendor comes to my office and says, with our solution, you'll be secure 100%, he loses my credit of trust. And I just stop listening to him, because he cannot actually manipulate us or thinks that we are that naive that there's actually a solution will make us 100% secure. The real actual power, which I highly appreciate and work on, is being resilient. Everyone is vulnerable to attacks, but the real power is how vigilant and resilient you are able to go back to your work and your operations as normal with the minimum impact and minimum time required. So what we have done here, we have that 2040 awesome strategy that lays out our 2040 years of initiatives. We have mapped our cybersecurity framework with that 34 capabilities, which was developed by our strategic partners, Deloitte, and map them to that initiatives for us to know which capabilities falls under which initiative in order for us to develop a roadmap of projects or let's say exercises, assessments to fulfill that maturity and capabilities building. So the maturity assessment after laying out and defining all of these initiatives consists of six main phases. First thing is knowing our business, defining our crown jewels. Second thing is to know what are the threat actors, what are the threat victors on these crown jewels, what are the impacts of these threats happens and their attacks happens, what are the disruptions that will be faced. The third phase is to know your current state. How bad are we? What are the gaps today? What we need to explore and to develop? Then, what's our target state and recommendations? And for that, you need to develop a reporting to your upper and C-suite member boards, as well as having a roadmap to map these recommendations into action. That maturity assessment took lots of time from us and lots of human efforts and hours. Throughout the 9 companies, and we talk about different 9 companies, different mindsets, different humans, different IT, different cybersecurity teams, we have done more than 150 interviews that took more than 400 questions and hours with the people and reporting analysis of hours. More than 2,000 questions has been surveyed within these each companies. 2 rounds of reviews for all of these results. And of course, more than 50 hours spent with each employee in these K companies in order to us to have a very clear and actually right to the as-is state and map it to the, not the perfect state, but what we have today in order for us to develop a very, we call it realistic roadmap to go for and thrive toward. We have done, this is just a sample, we have done a maturity board that shows all the 9 companies and how much they are mature and where are the gaps for all the 34 capabilities. We did not categorize, or we did not, let's say, gather and make them like one standard capability. We actually targeted each capability and carefully studied what are these capabilities, how each company is being measured toward that, in order for us to know how we can leverage that capability. Then, when we showed this slide, and it was showing all our 9 companies, this is just a sample. For me, when we showed it to a C-suite of oil sector management, I lived a moment of success. Because I was able to see from one dashboard which company is best in which capability. And that for me is a power by itself, because I can know that in, let's say, in encryption, X company has the best resources and they can be our mentor for all the other K companies to leverage and take best practices. And this goes with all the 34 capabilities. So instead of having their own initiative projects and their own different budgets, they can utilize and leverage the capabilities of each K company to make it best to the others. And this is where the unity and collaboration comes. And this is where my non-hashtag stronger together. Wherever we're together, we'll always be stronger. And this is where we also presented our companies and mapped them to the benchmark. But a word of advice, the industry benchmark is always being impacted by the other small companies who doesn't have that much impact of cybersecurity into the industry. So you always map yourself or put the target towards a higher benchmark in order for you to fulfill that gap and be able to address a more stable and recognized cybersecurity maturity. At the end, we have developed a dashboard of recommendations and as well as what are the gaps being seen. Of course, addressing the 3 pillars, and all of us know them: people, technology, and process. This has been carried out for each company within that cyber framework, and our leadership have that now visibility of where each company has their perfect, where they have their challenges, where these capabilities can be leveraged to the other K companies to take them to that maturity level as similar to them as well. After doing that, and it's not a one-man show. We always need to align with our national strategy. Being a national critical infrastructure, I mean, we always need to align with that. So we have that strategy that says you need always to raise the awareness. You need always to make sure that everyone is aware. And we have been doing that through different various and different forms. We have campaigns. As I said, one awareness campaign goes through the whole 9 companies, one voice, one message, and for us, this is an achievement by itself. My husband, who works in a different oil company, he took a picture of his screen piece and he said, "Reem, is this your work?" I said, "It's a teamwork." And yeah, this is our work. So we have the same vision. We have the same concerns. We have the same pains. And I'm sure that we have the same pains being shared with other entities in the industry itself. And from that, we have done. We not only stop within our K companies, and not only within KOC and not only within the national, we work on the community itself. Because at the end, this community will have inputs to us. These rising stars, these community that we are contributing it, will one day be our employees. So we have invested into raising and doing events, forums, and even CTF, Capture the Flag competitions, to realize and identify these capabilities and work in developing them. The other strategy is safeguarding the national critical infrastructure. And for that, we've been very much alerted in that. We have initiated communication channels with our CITRA, which is a regulatory information forum in Kuwait about cyber, that is taking care of cybersecurity. We have initiated with other entities that's also related to the cybersecurity in the company, in the country. And we made sure that we all work in that connection and close network of sharing the threat intelligence whenever that any incident or, let's say, a threat occurs into the region. And I believe all of you knows that the Middle East today is a very critical situations where the politics and the situations are very much emerging day by day. Promoting the cooperation of collaboration, we have promoted collaboration, as I said, within the sector, within the nation, even regional. We have established an oil and gas forum for a committee where we also collaborate in the cybersecurity aspect and matters. The way forward, the information security roadmap. So we have defined the roadmap after knowing all of our capabilities, all of our gaps, and let's say development areas, and whom we can utilize from these companies to address this one. And those capabilities who have, let's say, not that maturity, and we need a project actually to be established to address that. We have established all of that into one combination, having these main components into our roadmap. Of course, with that strategy, aligning us and giving us the vision and the way forward of the business strategy, we have tailored our roadmap, having the people, the technology, the process, as well as the framework guiding us through the way. The strategic outcomes, the main outcomes are here. We need always to define our baseline. As one of my friends always says, you can't do everything at the same time, especially with companies that large. We have more than 20,000 employees in my company, and the other key companies, you can count them as well, have also very challenging employees and size of business. So we always need to define our business minimum baseline. And if you recall what I said about defining the crown jewels, this works here. You need to work on your crown jewels. Have these being your prioritizing them, then build upon it your roadmap accordingly. Sharing the best knowledge, sharing knowledge and best practices. Sharing is caring, they say. In cyber, it works very fine. Once we contribute, once we share knowledge, once we share threat intelligence, this will just make us more aware. If the threat actors are sharing their knowledge and they are uniting their efforts toward their activities, why not us unite and share our knowledge to defend and build our defensible and capabilities towards raising that against that attacks. Adopting a common strategy to increase this maturity, this has helped us a lot, as well as being able from incident preparedness and from an experience by itself, having that community of collaboration, it enabled us to have visibility on the whole sector. So whenever an entity faces a challenge, this is being communicated through all the other 9 entities on the spot, and we take our measures and defensive actions at that spot. And this just works, makes us one step ahead and being a more better defensive position. The takeaways are 3. They always go tell me, you always go with 3 because more than 3 people will start forgetting. So I minimized it to only 3. Define your minimum baseline. Work on it and then work toward it and enhance as you go. There's nothing perfect, but if you will, and this has been done even recently, through an exercise. If we will try to fix the whole environment, it will be a very challenging actually to meet that fixing, because even during that implementation, within 2 months or 6 months, the rest of the plan that you have planned it actually gets obsolete and expired, because technology comes showing up, and this will not make any sense for that efforts you have built for that whole plan. So do it as stages, with starting with the crown jewels. Start collaborating. Our people in the community always say communicate, communicate, and communicate. We need to collaborate. We need to get the buy-ins from the business owners. We need to get the buy-ins from our leadership, where we have, thank God, fortunately, in our oil sector, a huge support has been gained from our leadership. Actually, they have been supportive that even a KPI, key performance indicator, has been utilized and stated on the whole oil sector for these C-suite. As SMAP is for cybersecurity, has been done and implemented for the past 2 years. And this by itself shows the commitment of our leadership towards this important component or important entity or element. Prioritize, as we said, and focus on your crown jewels. This is the main ultimate thing in your OT environment in being an oil and gas entity. Having that all done, or having all of this very clearly, as again I said, do your vision in collaboration with your business owners. Make them part of it. Don't be a one-man show. Have them handshake with you. Challenges will come, different mindsets. Be open to these different mindsets. Try to put yourself on their shoes and see what perspectives do they have. In Harvard, they told us this. They told us, although you believe in your perspective, and this is very good because you have this amazing technical experience where we as CISOs think and plan, I understand that because I'm a CISO myself. But recently, I've understood that I need to understand also the business perspective. I need to take myself out of that CISO hat and start putting that CIO hat. And this is actually a trick my CIO has put in putting me in his role for 2 weeks while he was on vacation. And I started realizing the burden of what a CIO was from a perspective of a CISO. So we need to understand this more often. I know it's a burden because we have so much things to do just being a CISO, but in order for us to have a success in our environment, we need to understand our CIO language, we need to understand our business owner language, and from that understanding, we can develop a collaborative and a clear strategic and a roadmap together. With that takeaways, I conclude my session, and I hope it was informative and insightful. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'll be more than glad to answer them.
Hi, my name is Joe Weiss. I'm the managing director of ISA 99. Which are the control system cybersecurity standards. Are you using any of the 62443s in what you've been doing?
Yes, our cybersecurity framework is actually it's a mixture of ISO 99, the NIST, the ISO 27000, and the NSA as well. So we're using a combination of all of that, because in Kuwait Oil Company and other companies, we have mixture environments.
Yes.
Whether it was even hospital, we have HIPAA. In our framework. So we have utilized all the cybersecurity related to our business operations and merged them into that cybersecurity framework to make them adaptable and flexible.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, Joe, for your question.
Hi, I'm Sean Lingus with CyberScoop. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about the way that the Trisys malware changed the way you view threats to industrial control systems in your space in Kuwait. I mean, obviously, you're aware of the threat to the region as a whole, but my understanding is that Kuwait has also had to deal with some of these issues and how that's kind of shaped how you look at safety and some of the threats to the control system space. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. Very good question. Having the our Saudi neighbors being impacted with the crisis, actually, as Rob Lee, has, the CEO of Dragos, has highlighted, that the threat actors took a different wave. They actually, with that attack. They actually targeted the humans, where they have tried to manipulate the safety systems in order to have that attack, where humans actually safety can be compromised. In our companies and our sector, actually, humans is a very high priority for us. The safety and lives of our employees is a priority always. So yes, we actually tried not to reinvent the wheel, and being an OT environment, we actually tried to utilize an existing vehicle, which is the process safety management. We have an entity by itself, which has been there for so long, but purely looking at the process management safety from their OT aspect. So we have utilized that entity and embedded within these cycles of assessment into that assets, our cybersecurity guidelines, our cybersecurity checkout list, in order for us to make sure as much as we can that these checks are being carried out through these process management safety exercises and audits. And this is done for the time being as a quick win. You always need to address quick wins when it comes to a very similar quick attack or a new environment knowledge that comes to your comes to you. So what we have done is a quick win by embedding our cybersecurity checkout list within this process safety management procedures and audits, and also developing and improving our OT roadmap to cater that safety aspect as well. Thank you, Sean.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ted Johnson, and I'm at Exelon, which is a utility here in the U.S. I was wondering, when you had your framework up there where you talked about the approach to assessing all of the applications, I guess, did you do that by network or did you do it by each application? And was it a risk-based approach? Can you just give us a little bit more of how you graded each application or each network?
So are you referring, just to understand your question better, you're referring to the how we address each application within the organization from that cybersecurity framework,
yeah,
right?
You had like a maturity model.
Yes.
Where you, I guess, came up with some kind of ranking or rating. Okay. Just tell us a little bit more about how you did that. Was it a risk-based approach or a little bit more how you scored them?
So what we have done here, we have done the BIA, Business Impact Analysis, and we have defined our applications, which are the critical ones. Again, we go with the crown jewels. So we defined all of our business applications, and we, from that BIA or Business Impact Analysis, we come to know which are the most critical applications. And from knowing this category of crown jewels, we address our controls, our initiative, our prioritizing in having that application being very well secured with adopting all the frameworks or the standards or the policies that framework provides and towards implementing it and securing these applications. I hope that answers the question. Thank you.
Okay, my name is Basil Hamden. I'm a professor, so I come from a different background of cybersecurity. Given your role as a CISO in your organization and given the unique nature of the systems that you try to protect, how do you think we are doing as probably people from academia in terms of preparing the future generation for the type of cyber threats that your organization and the like of which are facing? I know we always focus on traditional IT systems, but you have a different perspective. You work with different industry. So how good or bad in that sense do you think
we are
in
question?
Academia? yeah, to prepare people that you're seeking for the kind of skills that you want them to have.
Thank you for a question. Actually, we have two initiatives into academia and building a curriculum. In KOC, we have done a curriculum for two entities. One of them is for the diploma holders and the other one's for the bachelor degrees. And that curriculum was purely based on our requirements because, as you said, the current, at least back in Kuwait, the current outcomes are not actually matching our requirements, and we have to get all the new employees into SANS, boot camps, or all the other cybersecurity well-known organized in order to give them the sense of how cybersecurity will be in an IT environment or even an OT environment. And this by itself is an investment. So we said we need to fix the whole chain and work on that curriculum. We have hand-checked with academia, and I believe today we have so much actually promising programs of cybersecurity around the world. I know that one of our colleagues in KOC, he gave me a phone and he said, Dr. Reem, I'm sending my daughter high school to a cybersecurity program in UK. I just want to be here to become the next Reem in KOC. I said, this is excellent. So we have cybersecurity programs around the world, but in Kuwait, we are developing that. I know that we are working on that because as KOC, we're always initiating things and we cannot wait for that to happen. So I believe there's a big need to tailor the outcomes for today to understand instead of us investing more, which we'll be doing until that outcome gets, but it will be much easier if the academia works with us toward that ultimate achievement and outcome. Thank you so much.
Hello, my name is Jared. I'm wondering if you can speak to how you communicate risk, IT and cyber risk, to the C-level, what tools you may use.
Thank you, Jeff. When I first started, I was communicating badly. I was just giving them the blunt fact of how ugly we look like. And I get so much lesson learned from that because I see them a little bit lost in my language, my CISO language. And coming from a techie background, I don't want to lose them. I really want their buy-ins and their focus in order for them to give me the support I need. So I started to know their language. And when the challenge has been given to me is to give a presentation without mentioning the word of cybersecurity. And that by itself was a challenge. But understanding the objective behind that, because they were training me to understand how I can talk their language. So instead of telling them, this will have this much of hits and this incident and that event will actually accelerate to the DDoS attacks or whatever we can, and all the tricky terms, they told me, no, stop using that. Replace them with optimization, replace them with risk and impact on their business, how much it will cost if that business gets disrupted, how many hours of downtime it will cause. Then you will get their buy-in and you will understand their language and they will understand your language and they will give you the support needed. So from that, we have started to stop acting as CISOs the minute we walk into the C-suite and act as business cybersecurity champions, if I may put it in that way. And it's a continuous because every time we get something new to learn about and a challenge to go over. Thank you so much for the question.
Hi, my name is Ryan. You mentioned a couple times prioritizing crown jewels. I'm curious like how things stacked up among, you know, what became your crown jewels? Was it OT? Was it SCADA? Was it, you know, certain high value enterprise applications? How did that pan out?
Thank you, Brian. Prioritizing is a challenging thing. For me, being in KOC, everything is important and everything has to finish now. My team knows that. And when I start messaging them 3 a.m. in the morning and they get excited, they said, it's not urgent. I'm just taking it off my mind because I know tomorrow I might have other things in my mind. So I kept putting that prioritizing thing, even translating it. But for me as a CISO, everything is urgent. I need to do it now. But it will never make you successful in achieving toward a very huge environment or a corporate by itself. So our crown jewels is always the business. And in oil and gas, it's the SCADA. It's the OT environment. And all of that components. So what we have done is prioritizing all of these components as our crown jewels and analyzing the impact of them being disrupted, the cost of that disruption, and what are actually the threat actors or the threat victors of these being actually impactful, the risk impact and how much probability that risk item is actually that maps to these things. For example, if there was an item that or a component in SCADA that highly risk and has a big impact. However, the probability of it's happening is almost zero, or let's say 0.1, with another one that has more probability of being impacted, then this would play on our prioritizing matrix. So it's always prioritizing my matrix, looking at the risk and how the impact along with the probability of it's really happening. I hope this answers the question. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Andy. I'm just curious, after you rolled out your cybersecurity framework, and went through the first implementation. What challenges did you face with sustaining the program and continuously measuring it on an ongoing basis, and how did you face those challenges?
Excellent, excellent question. Thank you, Ryan. Working in your company is easy, and rolling out strategy and frameworks is easier, being the CISO of that company. But rolling it to other CISOs and other 8-9 companies is a challenge by itself, because you need to get their buy-in. You need to get them aligned that I'm not telling you and I'm not bossing you. It's just a collaborative alignment that we need to work together. We are humans, have different mindset. And again, understanding the other perspectives, knowing what their concerns, addressing them very nicely. You need always to be to take their buy-ins, because even if it comes from the top, and it did come from the top, if people themselves are not willing to do it, it will never be a success story. So you need really to have their buy-ins, to understand their language, and try to make it. It was very challenging at the start, and I'm not lying. It was very challenging. But once they felt our genuinity of KOC leading that initiative, actually our willingness in picking up the maturity of all other K companies into that initiative, companies started to catch up, although there was a little bit resistance at the beginning. But once they sense the genuinity, and we are humans, they really sense our genuinity. And what's your outcome? Nothing. I'm just trying to pick up the maturity for all of us, because at the all, we're all one. And once they feel that genuinity and there's no hidden agendas, they will join you and they will get in that train to that success story. And thank God it was challenging, but it was fruitful at the end. Thank you so much.
Sarah Malawi from Oredo.
Okay, so this will be the last question.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So do you see the oil and gas industry migrating to IoT and its ecosystem in the future? Do you see the oil and gas industry migrating to IoT? And how are you planning to manage those risks?
Thank you for your question. Actually, we have already POCs in IoT in the oil and gas industry. And the digital transformation gives us given that it will have these components into our environments. But again, we need to understand the business requirements and how it's being tailored to actually map to that strategic objective that OT is aligned to. And we will always do the security. Being a CISO is not blocking everything. Being a CISO is just securing that perspective, securing these disruptive technologies and emerging ones, and building a framework that is flexible and adaptable to this coming and emerging technologies. Thank you. Thank you so much for your question, and I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.